Thanks for the opportunity to speak here. And yeah, this is going to be a different kind of mathematical apocalypse. This one is much slower. So the biggest piece of progress is that I no longer put question mark next to progress, because this started around 2012, and we still have nothing to show for it, except that at the moment there actually is progress again. The first derivative has become positive again. Anyway, so what's the goal? So the goal is to try to get to a proof of homological mirror symmetry, one direction of it, in a fairly general setting, namely all smooth complete intersections in toric varieties. Okay. So first we need a setup, and okay, just so that you know in advance, this is going to be the B model, namely algebraic geometry on the complete intersections, and the A model will be on the mirror of a complete intersection. So I need to tell you what is the mirror of a complete intersection first. And so there's a setup which goes back probably all the way to Hori and Vafa, goes through many people. The version I will state is in joint work with Mohamed and Ludmil Katsarkov. So we start from a complete intersection in a toric variety, and by arbitrary I mean actually still near a tropical limit degeneration. So I want a smooth complete intersection but close to a tropical limit. So what do I mean by that? Well, for example, for me, what's a hypersurface? Maybe I should just start on a bigger board anyway. So if I want to define a hypersurface in C star to the n, I would just give it by one Laurent polynomial. And a Laurent polynomial for me would be a finite sum indexed by alpha in some finite set A of monomials of a form some constant times some parameter to some power. Rho is a function from A to R satisfying some convexity condition, times x to the alpha, and I would set that equal to 0 to get the defining equation of my hypersurface. Okay, here t is a parameter that goes to 0, so it's much smaller than 1, but it will take a numerical value if you want for some purposes, or actually in the context of this talk, it will be, you can think of it as the Novikov parameter for the mirror A model.
Why is it not that serious in T? The alpha is fixed, you can have a sum of T.
Well, because I just want to study algebraic hypersurfaces, okay? I don't know how to build mirror symmetry for things where the sum is not finite. Ah, well, C alpha could be a power series in T.
Oh.
Okay? C alpha is a scalar for a suitable notion of scalar. So it could be an, you know, if you're on the Novikov world, then this is the leading term, and this, you know, this is the valuation of my coefficient, and this is the whole rest of the thing. Okay? So, you could say C alpha is a unitary element of the Novikov field, if you're in the Novikov world. Okay, and this is just a shorthand notation for some Laurent monomial. And okay. So now if I'm in a toric variety V, I can just think of a toric variety as a compactification or partial compactification of C star to the n. So there will be something similar, except now F will be a section of some line bundle L. Okay. But I would still think of it as the same formulas. And if I have a complete intersection, then I just have several such things. Several line bundles. Okay. Oh, I think I just lost an eraser. No, not sure what happened. Okay. So, what's the mirror of this? It's a Landau-Ginzburg model. Where the total space, okay, so it's called Y comma W, where Y is a toric Calabi-Yau variety of dimension. So if I'm sitting in n dimensions, this is an n plus k fold, where k is the codimension again. Right, so again, I'm looking at codimension k in a toric n fold. And since I'm going to be doing symplectic geometry on it, I might as well describe it by its moment polytope. So what is its moment polytope? Well, it's going to be something in dimension n plus k. And I can describe it as everything that sits above the graphs of certain piecewise linear functions of n variables, phi 1 to phi k. What is phi I? It's the tropicalization of fi. And so by tropicalization, we mean the max over all alphas that occur in here of the linear function given by alpha minus rho of alpha. Okay, this is how I choose to tropicalize. This might be a different sign convention from some others. Okay. So this is the space for the mirror. And the superpotential will have two types of terms in it. So one of them, if you want, records the complete intersection nature of things. There's one term for each codimension. And these are just toric monomials. With weight corresponding exactly to the eta I coordinate. Okay, so for each of these last k coordinates, I have a toric monomial with that weight. I put a minus sign in front, which is dear to me and some other people. At first glance, you might not worry too much. And you have these. And then you have more terms, which come from the toric variety. So some index by the rays of a fan of V. I'm not sure I want to give them a name. Of some coefficients. Let's call these guys nu. Some power of some other variable T, which would have been the Novikov parameter if this were the complex side, but we're just going to treat that as a numerical parameter, times Z to V nu, comma some alpha of nu. So basically the terms correspond, sorry, let me write them again. So some coefficient. So nu is a ray of a fan. Sorry, it's a primitive generator of a ray of a fan of V. It's some constant times some other constant times a monomial with exponent nu, exactly the ray of a fan in the first variables. And on the other k variables, it's basically the largest evaluation of any such alpha that occurs on that generator. Don't worry about what it is. This is impossible to understand at first sight, so, you know. Main thing to remember is there's terms of this kind and there's terms of that kind. All right. And then there's possibly plus dot 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 that we don't understand.
Right.
But the dot 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 is irrelevant for this side of mirror symmetry. At least I believe we can prove mirror symmetry without worrying about these guys. So let's not worry about them. The side where we will be doing symplectic geometry on this, and we are doing algebraic geometry on that. Okay. So, just to orient yourself again, I'm caring about db co of h, and I'm going to care about the Fourier category. Sorry. Yes.
So, presumably that means that, you know, when you add the correction terms, there will be no extra singularities.
That is probably true, but we are not going to look at the singularities of W anyway, because that's too hard.
Well, but they will but affect
yes,
the outcome.
They will affect. So these other terms tend to be of higher Novikov valuation and with exponents that are in the convex hull of these other exponents. And so for that reason, they should not affect the outcome significantly with the setup we'll use.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, yeah. No, doesn't have to at least, okay? If it's compact, I mean, I think in general, you know, for sanity, I like to assume that it's Fano or semi-Fano, but that's probably not necessary. At least I don't see where we use it in the current scheme of proof.
Do you want to assume anything about line bundles?
The line bundles need to be at least numerically effective. Let's say there may be, well, at least big. Big would be good, probably.
No. Really?
No.
Numerical effective should be
probably. Yeah, it's probably enough. Anyway, I don't want them to be I like to assume, if you want that, okay, so I'm going to state that in a, you know, very down-to-earth way. I feel more comfortable if I assume that these tropicalizations do involve all the variables. Okay? That's basically the, you know, if I could have cut down to a subtorus before doing all of this, I should have done it beforehand. Otherwise, I might have too much stuff that I don't care about. So it's mostly a degeneracy in the notations. You know, the setup should reduce just fine. Okay. So, you know, at this point, you're probably confused. So the basic example to think of is the pair of pants. The n minus one dimensional pair of pants, which is just the hypersurface given by x1 plus dot 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 plus xn plus 1 equals 0 inside C star to the n. Okay? And so the mirror of that, according to this recipe, well, y ends up, okay, so the tropicalization of that and some being basically max of xi1 dot 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 xin 0. And what lives over the graph of that, well, it's slanted in space, but it's congruent to a standard octant. So that the mirror ends up just being c to the n plus 1 when you fix the coordinates properly. And the superpotential, this monomial, ends up being just minus the product of the coordinates, vanishes to order one on each divisor, okay? And now, so that's in C star to the n, and if you want a good compactification example to think of, well, you can compactify to pn minus one inside pn, just by compactifying C star to the n to cpn, and of course now you homogenize this. So you just get the linear subspace given by sum of coordinates equal to 0. And what that does, Well, it doesn't change the nature of a complete intersection, but it changes, it adds these compactification terms. Plus t z to the n plus 1. Okay, so that's the effect of compactification. Okay, and you can check that compared to your usual mirror to Pn minus 1 on its own right, this is a dimensional stabilization. This is dimension 2 higher, but it has actually the same critical points and critical values as the regular, usual, familiar mirror to Pn minus 1. Okay. So, questions with the setup? Big T is some parameter which, well, because we're going to do symplectic geometry, it doesn't matter what it is. If you were doing algebraic geometry here, it would come from the Novikov parameter of the Fourier category of these guys. Okay, so you can take it to be a small numerical quantity for our purposes. Yes? So it's, okay, so it's, in the case of a hypersurface, there's only one eta. The, you know, so this equation becomes eta bigger than the tropicalization. If you think just of the one-dimensional pair of pants, maybe I should say this first. So the one-dimensional pair of pants inside C star squared, I get phi is max of xi1, xi2, 0. The graph of that, well, it's hard to picture, but you know, imagine now what sits above this. You know, you have something flat here, it slopes up there, take everything above that. That looks like an octant, it's just been slanted. And now the monomial we take, well, just two zeros here, it's the monomial that corresponds to the vector that points straight up. In particular, it always vanishes to order one on each facet. And so it's just the product of the coordinates. It's a general feature for hypersurfaces and for complete intersections. You just want to be more careful what you say. But
does the hypersurface know about this mirror? I mean, can you recover it from the hypersurface, or is it hypersurface together with this embedding in C star to the n?
This particular mirror depends very much on the embedding into C star to the n. I mean, for example, the mirror I got for Pn minus 1 as a hyperplane in Pn is not even of the same dimension as if I had thought of it as some other kind of complete intersection. Now, we believe that all the mirrors we get in this way will have equivalent categories, and in some cases you can check that they match each other by a sequence of stabilizations, destabilizations, or, you know, cut out a formal neighborhood and things like operations that are known not to really matter. But the construction is very ad hoc. Okay? So, all right. So now there's two kinds of mirror symmetry you could look at. One has to compare the Fourier category of H with the derived category of singularities of this guy, and that's the one I will not talk about today. Okay, that one, well, there's been work done. I mean, the case of Riemann surfaces is understood. Higher pants are a bit of a mystery, but mostly under control. But if you look at compactifications, especially things like Fermat hypersurfaces, then the, you know, key reference is standing at the back of the room. I mean, Nick is probably well ahead of us on that direction.
I'm sorry, can you write it down, the thing that you're not going to talk about?
Well, the thing I'm not going to talk about is the Fourier or the wrapped Fourier category of H should be equivalent to DB sync of W. Okay, I'd rather not confuse an already confusing picture even further by. Okay, so we'll write statements to avoid the question of is this a theorem, and I will try to say a bit more about what the current statement is, what the current status is. So one is we can define fiber-wise wrapped and fiber-wise admissible Okay, a category for this kind of thing. And really, you know, you can hope to generalize a little bit, but basically the definition only makes sense on these examples. That's the current statement. The whole definition is built around using the fact that Y is toric and that the potential takes this kind of shape. Yes, well, what it is, whether it's one or the other depends on whether V is compact or non-compact. Okay, so if I'm doing, I mean, in general, it might be both. If I'm looking at things inside C star to the N, sorry, no, it will be both. Okay, it's both, but it's...
What is it?
I will clarify. I will explain what I mean. I'm making up names anyway. The point is, I'm saying there is some flavor of Fourier category that we believe we can define for these examples, and essentially only for these examples. So the hope for a less ad hoc construction would be maybe, you know, either Zach Sylvan's thesis or the recent work in progress of Ganatra, pardon, Shende, or something might give something better. But we like ours because ours is designed to be computable. It's not designed to be general, it's designed to be computable by specific techniques. Okay. The second thing is we can actually construct objects. There are some objects in this category. Let's call them L sub L. Sorry, there's going to be an orgy of L's of this category for all line bundles on the ambient toric variety V. Okay. So, and conjecturally, they generate. But it's kind of hard to know what you mean by generating in a category that's been defined in a really ad hoc way, in that if you don't know yet what objects it has. But anyway, at least on simple examples, it looks like it should work. And then the third part of the statement is we can calculate home spaces between these things, at least in cohomology so far. I'm putting cohomology because of my lack of understanding of Mohammed's thesis, basically. But I believe that you should be able to remove cohomology fairly easily. And you'll find that this should match with the X groups over in dB of H of the restrictions of these line bundles. Okay. And first of all as vector spaces, but also with the ring structure. And of course, what you would want is a chain level enhancement that also includes higher products. And then you would be done. Well, you would be kind of done if you can prove a chain level version of this. Then you conclude that the subcategory of dB of H consisting of line bundles restricted from the ambient variety so we would get after enhancing that the subcategory of dB co of H consisting of line bundles restricted from V, from the ambient toric variety, is equivalent, derived equivalent, something, to the subcategory of this Fourier category, consisting of these objects that I haven't told you yet how to think about. Okay, and you would hope that these are enough to generate the actual categories you care about. Okay, so at this point, I will need to clarify what these constructions are about. So these statements 1, 2, 3 need clarification. But is the general statement more or less okay? So the, you know, truth in advertising can define is the one that's least far along. Yes, that one, I mean, at least in all, you know, yes, I think these always generate, at least in all examples I can think of. There might be some, you know, assumption I'm missing, but yeah, I don't think so. Yeah, okay. Yeah, so that one is really, that one will be everything. That one we expect will be everything, but to be checked. It might depend also on whether we've defined this category in the right way in the non-Fano case. Okay, so, sorry, is there a question? Okay. All right. So, you know, current status, is the hardest part is having a good definition where you can check that all the maximum principles you want hold and so on. So at this point, we have it for pairs of pants. And I believe that we kind of have it for hypersurfaces in full generality, and then complete intersections will follow easily. So there's still some work being done on that, but basically we are there, and it looks completely technical. But again, with maximum principles, there's no such thing as completely technical. Construction of objects comes in tandem with that. Basically, the definition of this is done so that we can have these objects. So it works as well. And the calculation is, at that point, it's basically understanding the organizer's respective theses. I mean, it's basically Paul Seidel's technology on Lefschetz vibrations together with the slight computational enhancements that came in James' thesis. I'm also planning to use the thesis of my current students, but okay. All right. So let's talk a bit about what kind of Fourier category we want to think about, because it's probably not the one you have in mind. Unless you've seen me give a talk before, in which case you know what I'm going to say. Okay, so first part is, what is the Fourier category of this thing? So the conventional wisdom about the Fourier category of a Landau-Ginzburg model is that you want Lagrangian submanifolds whose image under the potential, well, there might be a blob, you know, in a bounded subset, but at infinity, they should go to infinity in just one direction. So we're going to change that in various ways. Okay? So first way we're going to change that is that instead of just one direction, we're going to allow several directions at infinity, but all within a given angular sector. You can think of the right half plane, or technically all you need is make sure that you never go to minus infinity. So, the kinds of things we want.
I've heard you talk before about these thimbles. Is it still like where the thimbles are going out?
They're not thimbles. But yes, this would be related to how thimbles are going out in a more classical setup. Okay? So the objects are going to be properly embedded Lagrangian submanifolds, L in Y. For simplicity, we are going to assume not bounding any holomorphic disks. Or you could, you know, this is going to be enough for our purposes, but you could instead assume that it's just unobstructed and that you've been able to cancel the disks somehow, possibly with a bounding co-chain. Okay, but for simplicity, let's say it doesn't bound any holomorphic disks. And what we are going to want is that the image of L under, so normally I would put the whole superpotential, and I'm going to swindle you and instead say under each of the main, so I will think of the first few terms, W0i, so these monomials. Okay. So in the case, I've already raised my example, but in the case of a hypersurface in C star to the n, there's only one monomial coming in the superpotential, and that's the one I want to use. If I'm compactifying, I will be adding extra terms. I will ignore those for now. I'm just going to consider the main projection coming from the C star to the n. If I have a complete intersection, I will have k different projections, one for each codimension, and I will treat those separately. So the image under each of these is outside of a compact subset, a union of radial straight lines e to the I theta r plus, where theta is not pi. Okay, or you could say theta is between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. If you prefer, it doesn't change anything. Okay, so that tells you what happens under these projections. But I should still have some other compatibility conditions. And maybe one thing I should point out before we spell the other compatibility conditions out is that the common fiber of, this is just the regular fibers, the fiber of, let's call that vector W0, which is the first k terms. This is a map from y to c to the k over a point of c star to the k is, it looks like c star to the n. That's a fact that you can check by computing on things. Maybe the simple example to think about for the pair of pants, we were looking at c to the n plus 1 with minus the product of the coordinates. If you set the product of the coordinates to be some non-zero value, you get a copy of c star to the n. Okay? So, why I'm holding my notes, because what I'm saying has nothing to do with my notes, basically. At some point it might. Okay. So now what I will want is within these fibers. Sorry, and maybe I should have said, and over the toric strata, it's a toric degeneration of C star to the n to some union of toric varieties. So for example, for the pair of pants, the zero fiber is product of coordinates equals zero is a union of copies of C to the n, which combinatorially glue, it's a degeneration of C star to the n to a union of affine spaces. Okay? So within these fibers, what do we want? So there's a condition that's called currently asymptotic flatness, which is what we use to control both admissibility for the additional terms of the superpotential and to have reasonable estimates on holomorphic curves. Okay, so the condition is that Where did I put the condition? Yes. So there exists a finite collection of toric monomials on C star to the n. So on this fiber-wise C star to the n. Well, let's just say on Y, actually. But you should think of them as being monomials that probe the C star to the n direction. And an open cover U alpha of Rn, such that for fixed value of the main terms, as z goes to infinity, sorry, what do I mean by toric monomials? I need to give them names. Z to the alpha. No, I already have too many alphas. Z to the lambdas, u lambda, as z goes to infinity with log norm z in u lambda, the argument of z to the lambda is equal to some fixed constant c sub lambda. Okay, so, and moreover, lambda include rays of a fan of v. So this is like a weird condition which says the following thing. Within the fibers, I have the fibers are C star to the n's, and inside that I have Lagrangians, which may be non-compact. And if they're non-compact, then I want to control the argument of toric monomials at infinity. Okay? And the way I will want to do it is by requiring that certain chosen set of spanning toric monomials must be, say, you know, if you set these constants to be zero, real positive at infinity. So real positive outside of a compact subset. Okay? So, for example, staying with a pair of pants, if I'm looking at c to the n plus 1 minus z0 zn, we can ask, so basically, for fixed value of a superpotential, as z goes to infinity in any direction, so as you escape from any, you know, from a compact subset, whenever norm zj is bigger than 1, argument of zj equals 0. Sorry, that was meant to be on the Lagrangian. Such that for fixed things, z on the Lagrangian L. Okay, so that's a pretty strong version. You know, it's a very explicit version of it. The condition for the pair of pants just looks like this: every variable that's bigger than 1 is real positive inside. Sorry, this should not be 1 because this is for fixed W. W to V 1 over plus 1. Okay, doesn't matter. Okay, so some constant depending on the value of the superpotential. Mm-hmm. 2. Sorry. Okay. All right.
Can I ask for thus the two-dimensional pair of pants?
Sorry, so, for the two-dimensional pair of pants?
Yeah.
So the mirror would be c to the 4 with you mean the two-dimensional or 4, 2 over
the
what?
One, a low-dimensional one.
Okay.
About what these conditions, particularly this one, means.
So, okay, so let's draw a picture maybe for the one-dimensional pair of pants, okay, which will be c cubed with the product of the coordinates with a minus sign, okay? Mm-hmm. So, okay, so I have a base projection. In the base projection, I have a blob and radial lines. Within the fibers, let's mostly worry about the fibers. You know, they could be anywhere. I mean, eventually the things I look at are strictly fibered anyway. There's no blob part. But the condition would be, so let's look, say, in one of these fibers. In one of these fibers, I will look like a Lagrangian in C star squared. So I have L intersecting the fiber, let's call that little L in C star squared, and I can project it under, say, the log map, or the moment map. I should use actually the moment map for the toric structure to get to R squared. So, you know, this C star squared is really Z0, Z1, Z2 equals some constant. And the Z0 axis kind of points here, the Z1 axis, Z1 and Z2 axis point in these directions. So I want to ask that over this whole region here, Z2 is real positive. Over this whole region here, Z1 is real positive. And over this whole region here, Z0 is real positive. And on the overlaps, well, two of them are real positive. The third one then is not real positive because its argument is given by whatever argument you're going along in the base direction that fixes the product. But that's basically what's going on. Okay? So now these conditions look very strong and very unnatural. And in fact, if you put equals, which is what we want, then you cannot use the standard Kähler form of C to the n. Standard Kähler forms would only have a property that these guys converge to constant values. I mean, you know, just basic fact, sorry, that's clear to people in the school of Paul Seidel and not to the others, is that when you parallel transport, you know, Lagrangians that are fibered over arcs must be obtained from taking a Lagrangian in the fiber under parallel transport by the symplectic orthogonal to the fiber. So now you can ask, well, what's the geometry of parallel transport? Does it preserve this fiber-wise condition? And the answer is, for the standard Kähler form, it does so only in a limit sense. It preserves, standard parallel transport preserves a property that arguments converge to constant values at infinity. But I'm not good enough with complex analysis to prove a maximum principle when the Lagrangian boundary conditions only have this convergence property. So our current plan is to use different Kähler forms. I can give you an explicit formula for this example. It involves a lot of stories about convex smoothings of a maximum function, so that equality is strictly true. Okay? So the caveat is with equal, this only works with non-standard toric Kähler forms. But you probably wouldn't be able to tell the difference anyway. With a standard Kähler form, you get converges too, and I think things should be okay, but I can't quite prove that it's well defined. Okay, sorry, so maybe a further comment here, since we have the example of a pair of pants. So remember, the mirror, if I compactify, the pants to CP1 inside CP2, then we're adding these monomials that are exactly T times Z0, the superpotential becomes minus Z0, Z1, Z2, plus constant Z0, plus constant Z1, plus constant Z2. Well, look what we've done. We've ensured that whenever one of these terms is not small, it's actually real positive. This is exactly what's usually thought of as admissibility for this kind of potential. Well, this is close enough to what's usually thought of as admissibility for this kind of potential. So the upshot will be that fiber-wise, in the fibers of the main projection, I'm going to call that main projection, to C to the K, L is admissible for the extra terms coming from the toric variety. I forgot what notation I used, I think W sub V or something like that. Yes?
So in this case, there's U0, U1, and U2?
Yes.
And they overlap?
Yes, or they more than overlap, because...
is there a triple overlap?
No, okay. At infinity, you know. I mean, the condition is only, anyway, as Z goes to infinity.
Ah.
Okay? So, anyway, you can say, yeah, it's a cover of a complement of a bounded subset, if you prefer to think of it that way. Or, you know, I could artificially add any bounded piece since my condition was outside the compact set. Okay. And of course, that's a choice of overlaps that's kind of tailored to compactification to CP2. If I were compactifying to something else, then I would try to build this with a different cover. But, you know, once you control the actual coordinates, it's easy to control monomials in the coordinates. Okay. So now we have the setup, basically. And I have 5 minutes to tell you the whole rest of the story. So let's try that. So what is, you know, sorry, oh, no, I don't have the setup. So next thing to discuss, briefly, is that rho t is going to be a flow on each c, which is the base of the main terms. Okay, so in these pictures, we can think of a flow that moves radial lines counterclockwise without crossing R minus. Okay. So what it will do is that this Lagrangian, you know, maybe it stays the same here, but at infinity, it will then bend to go to infinity in different directions, which should be straight, except I couldn't jump high enough. Okay, so every radial direction gets moved counterclockwise, but you never cross, you never get to minus infinity. Some autonomous flow. And you can lift, basically using the geometry of parallel transport, to get rho t of L still Lagrangian, some action on admissible Lagrangians, which maps them to admissible Lagrangians. Basically, you use angular and radial parallel transport to rectify the directions you go to at infinity. And so that's what you do in the base. And fiber-wise, you want another Hamiltonian. Phi t is going to be some Hamiltonian preserving the fibers of the main projection and acts basically wraps at constant pace in the fibers. So I'm thinking of the case of C star to the n. Okay, so in the case of C star to the n, it's a Hamiltonian with linear growth in the moment map coordinates of a fiber, growing, you know, proper. And what it does is it just spins. Well, in the case of C star to the, in the case of the plants, it just spins each of z0, z1, and z2 at a unit rate at infinity in its respective directions. Okay. In the case of a toric variety, instead of wrapping all the way, I will take infinitesimally small wrapping in the directions corresponding to the rays of a fan. So in fact, it's built using the same set of monomials that we are talking about here. And depending on whether these are parts of a fan of V or not, you either have a very small positive slope, or you have, you know, integer slope, say 1. So what you do with these Hamiltonians, sorry, phi t is a Hamiltonian, rho t is not a Hamiltonian. But it's an operation that takes admissible Lagrangians to admissible Lagrangians. So then you define Lt to be phi t rho t L. Doesn't matter in what order. These two operations commute, because one moves in the base, the other one moves in the fiber. And in either order. And then you define Hom L L prime to be the limit. There's a set of continuation maps as you increase the value of t in Fleur theory. And you take the Fleur complexes of Lt with L prime. So the observation here is the control we have over the arguments of things at infinity and the behavior of phi t tell you that for all but a discrete set of t's, these Lagrangians are well separated at infinity, and Fleur theory is well defined. Okay, so well defined due to fiber-wise behavior at infinity. being controlled, both in the base radial directions and in the fiber argument directions, for all but a discrete set of T. Okay. So, this point I should get close to something. When did I start? Do I have?
You have like 10 extra.
Oh, okay, okay. I'll try to take less than that, but okay, that's still going to be slightly easier. Okay, so basically, you know, the slogan is you define morphisms by pushing in the base and pushing in the fiber. Pushing in the fiber is as appropriate depending on whether you're in a non-compact setting or a compact setting. So maybe the comment here is that in the fiber of this main map, what we have is C star to the N, I've told you, together with exactly the superpotential that's mirror to the toric variety V. This is exactly the mirror, the toric mirror, to V. Okay, and phi T, the fiber-wise perturbation I'm taking, is, well, the extreme case is when V is compact, it's basically defining what is usually called the Fouquier-Seidel category of this potential. And when you don't compactify, when V is just C star to the N, then this is just the linear wrapping for the wrapped Fouquier category. And it's in between for partial compactifications. So now the general slogan we'll use is that we can start from mirror symmetry for V and produce a mirror to restriction to the complete intersection H. How does that work? So maybe one last thing I should say is at W0 equals minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, this is canonical. These identifications here. What I mean by that is, well, if you look at the pair of points, which I keep, no, it's still here vaguely, if I set minus the product of the coordinates equal to minus 1, that means I'm setting the product of the variables equal to 1, and that copy of C star to the N is nicer than the others in that it has a real positive part. And that's what I mean by a canonical identification. Okay, so it's really the toric mirror to V rather than something that's isomorphic to it. Okay. So now what do we do given a line bundle L on V? First thing we do is we read Mohammed's thesis. Okay? And Abu Zaid's thesis gives a Lagrangian, let's call it L, little l of L, inside C star to the N, which is actually a graph over the log map or the moment map. Okay. You have to read it between the lines to get it to fit exactly with the setup we have here. Okay, it's a slight modification. Andrew Hanlon's thesis will have the complete details on that, unless we actually write up first, but anyway, it's going to be there at some point. I suspect that Andrew will have a permanent job before we finish writing our paper. Okay. So, all right. So now what we do with this Lagrangian is we parallel transport L of L over, well, there's each, you know, there's k copies of C for these k main terms. And for each of them, the critical value is at 0. And we're going to ignore 0 because we started at minus 1 anyway. We're going to parallel transport over something that's shaped like that. Okay, so it's radial at infinity. And it conveniently avoids the origin, which is the only place where we had singularities in the fibers, and just goes around. Okay? And so there's a calculation involving angular parallel transport and checking that indeed we set it up so that the fiber-wise admissibility was preserved. Namely, all the large variables had constant arguments. Even as you spin things, as you move around, it's only the small variables that change arguments. And what this gets you is something that we'll call L of L. That's the object. So now you can ask, what do home spaces between these look like? Well, of course, we need to push by the perturbations in the base and in the fiber. By definition, this is some sort of Fleur complex between the time t perturbed version of L of L, and so it's a limit of these things. But I'm going to draw the pictures for a finite large value of t, and that should be enough to convince you. Okay? So what happens in the base? What happens in the fiber? In the base, so by base, again, I mean these k main projections. What happens in each of them is the same. Right? I started with something that looked like this sort of U shape. And I will push it around, so it will start looking like this kind of shape. And past the time when this leg goes through that one, nothing else really changes qualitatively. This keeps moving, 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 but the picture remains the same. So in each of these k coordinates, I have two fibers where things intersect. In general, I get 2 to the k fibers of W0 where intersections happen. Okay, so if I just have a hypersurface, it's just this. Otherwise, it's k copies of that. It will give you a cube. Okay. So now what happens inside the fibers? Well, this one is the simplest. Because what do we have in the fiber here? Well, we have C star to the N, and but with a potential W sub V. And inside that, we have little L of L and little L of L prime.
Is it
L prime? No, this is a different, you know, I'm taking two different line bundles on the toric variety V, and I'm repeating the construction with both. Okay, so these two objects, they just look like any two Lagrangians from Mohammed's thesis. Okay, so what does Mohammed's thesis tell us? It tells us that in this fiber, the Fleur complexes of L of L, L of L prime, look like, what should I say, X in the derived category of V of L and L prime. And this is homological mirror symmetry for the toric variety V. More precisely, what you get is some Morse type chain complex that's equivalent to a check complex calculating this from an affine cover of V. Okay? So maybe I should say check model. Check complex computing this is more correct, okay, for the standard affine cover of your toric variety. So now what happens in the other fiber, the one to the right? Here, well, this still looks less canonically, but this still looks like the mirror to V. But now, see, if you parallel transport, sorry, so this one should have been L prime, sorry, L of L prime. This one is L of L, pushed by time t. So what happens here is, you know, I can identify following along, say, L prime if I want. And then I will still have L of L prime. But what I have here, sorry, what I have from L then has been moved all around the central fiber compared to that. So I pick up the monodromy around the central fiber. And the calculation is that the monodromy around the central fiber shifts the arguments of these Lagrangian sections exactly in a way that corresponds to the tensor product with the defining equation. So this is what did I call that? I think I called it L sub I. Sorry for. So Li is the ith defining line bundle. Yes, exactly. OK, so to get to the point, what we will get in general is we get 2 to the k pieces, which look like the Fleur complexes in the fiber, so in maybe C star to the n with the potential of V, I should say Hom, between, so the first one, sorry, L, little l of L tensor Li, comma L tensor L of L prime, where Li is the tensor product of any subset of 1 to k of the defining equations. You get these Homs fiberwise, which correspond to, via Mohammed's thesis, to a check model for x of L tensor Li L prime. And there's connecting differentials, the connecting differential count holomorphic sections over these kinds of bigons. Okay? And so the connecting differentials is where you need to use basically tricks inspired from James' thesis and from Paul Seidel's book, where you kind of compute this count of sections indirectly by using test objects and using the Seidel TQFT for pushing this fiber out of the way. And the upshot will be that this operation, when you think of these in terms of homogeneous polynomials on V, will be exactly multiplication by the defining equation. Maybe I should point out the singular strata here are indexed exactly by the monomials in the defining equation. And you get one family of holomorphic sections for each of these toric divisors. And their count, suitably done, gives you back multiplication by Fi, which was, remember, the section of Li giving the ith equation of my complete intersection. So when I look at all of these together, I get a cube, which is the causal complex for, well, a check model for the x groups of this thing. And at the end, I should get x for the restrictions of these line bundles to the complete intersection. And the product is trivial compared to the differential. But you know, if you can understand this, you can understand the product. OK, thank you.